Just we need to remember that nobody come to Oriental dance classes to be a professional belly dancer. They come just for fun, to forget their work, to think about something else, just to enjoy. So we need to remember this.
Welcome to Bellydance Live podcast with weekly portion of stories, tips and dance inspiration. My name is Iana Komarnytska, I'm your host and I invite you to explore all nuances of Bellydance Live together with me and our amazing guests. Let's start. This episode is brought to you by the support of our Patreon community. If you're interested in supporting this podcast as well as getting more dancing into your life, don't forget to check our new Patreon page. Technique drills, dance choreographies, as well as individual feedback for your own dance videos and dance creations, all available at different tiers of our Patreon account. You can check it at patreon.com/yanadance. Link is in the show notes to this episode. Hello everyone, welcome to Bellydance Live podcast. Welcome back to the show. I must say that last week was quite an epic. To be exact, that relocating from one continent to another, it's not a joke. And last week completely threw me off my regular schedule and routines, but now back to norm. I am right now already in Ukraine, in Kiev, and very excited to go next week for a dance weekend in Warsaw, organized by Alia and Vladimir Klitschnikovy. So if you see me somewhere at that festival, don't be shy and come by and say hi. I am always so happy to meet our listeners and know who is listening to this podcast. So if you see me walking around at in Poland next weekend, again, don't be shy to come and say hi. Drum rolls, attention, we have Marta Korzun back on our podcast. I'm so excited. She was our very first guest ever on the podcast. It was episode number one. We were recording that episode without even show existing in the world, and I had to sort of explain the concept and what it will be like, but I'm very grateful that Marta had trust and belief in this project, and she contributed her time back then to record the episode, and now she's back 77 episodes after. Marta Korzun is definitely recognized as one of the world's leading performers and teachers of Oriental dance. She started her career in 2006 and she was very active in the beginning, participating in many competitions in Ukraine and abroad, including in Cairo. She had numerous awards and eventually she became one of the most invited and popular judges at the competition. So I remember in the first episode that we recorded, episode number one, she talked a lot about her first experience in the competitions, as well as her opinion about current competition scene from both perspectives as a recent or relatively recent participant and now a very active invited guest judge. Marta is also artistic director of one of the largest School of Oriental Dance in the Eastern Europe, Tiara, and the ensemble Tiara Stars. She's recognized for her unique teaching method and clear and concise explanations, and regularly holds training workshops all around the world. She's also host of her own dance festival, as well as she's working currently, almost finished working on her current online project, online course for teachers that we started talking about in our, again, previous episode, but now she's actually about to launch it right now in August. So within a few weeks of releasing this episode, you can already see more details about this course, but for now I will just put a link in the show notes to some part of the videos from this course, so you can definitely check it out right away. But keep an eye and follow Marta on social media, and keep an eye for her announcement about launching about this course. Because in this interview, in contrast to our previous conversation, we focused more on the teaching aspect of ballet dance field, ballet dance industry, and she gave so many numerous very useful tips for young teachers. How, first of all, to know that you're ready to teach, how to prepare for your first class, and how to make sure that your students stay with you and keep coming back again and again, as well as she gave some business tips on, in general, approaching your activities, your dance activities, as well as specifically promoting your dance classes. So this episode is literally, truly the treasure jewel for all teachers, and especially young teachers or those dancers who are thinking about starting teaching career. And if you're interested more to know about personally Marta's dance journey and her path, I really encourage you to go back to episode number one. And if you didn't listen it, listen right now, because it was a lot of valuable information about individual path as a dancer and her development of her career. And even if you listened back then, it's always good to go back and re-listen, because you always find something new that you missed a first time. So now, without any further delay, let's dive right into the interview. But just before that, a quick thank you for our awesome supporters of this podcast, Bellydance Evolution. Join Jelena's Bellydance Evolution 10-year anniversary celebration, workshops, hafla, and best of BDE show featuring stars Sharon Kihara, Kaeshi, Kader, Jelena, and more. August 20 to 25 in Los Angeles, California. Also, BDE has opened auditions for their performance in Buenos Aires, Argentina, this October. Auditions close September 3rd. Visit bellydanceevolution.com for more details. Oh my God, guys, can you believe this? We have Marta Korzun back on our podcast. It's so, so exciting. And thank you, Marta, for coming and joining us today. And also, thank you for being our very first guest ever. It was our episode number one when we recorded our previous interview with you. So I'm so, so happy to have you back. And there are so many things that happened since then.
Thank you so much. I'm very, very happy. And thank you for invitation. Very happy to come back and to be the first at this podcast. Oh my goodness. That's so exciting.
So I think it was about 1 year and a half when we recorded our previous interview. It was like last February of the previous year.
I think so, yeah.
What have been the major changes in your dance life since then? Or what may be something that really excites you right now, currently, that just appeared in the last year?
First of all, I think in my dance life, everything is good as before. But as we talked with you before, that now the number one priority in my life, it's my family, and I decided to travel a little bit less, so I don't accept every invitation like before, because I want to have more time for my family. But it's, I still have a lot of invitation. It's like about 25-30 festivals per year, that it's still a lot. But anyway, it's less than I traveled before. And I'm really happy about that, because I feel balance. I feel harmony in my life now, because I think before my job was number one, but not family and me also, and my personal life, and of course my dance. So this is the main changes, I think, in my dance life. And also, I launched two instructional videos and working on my online teaching course for teachers, for belly dance teachers. I know people waiting too long for this, but I really work so hard and I want to have it the best quality and to be this very interesting, and it takes a lot of time, so that's why it's so long. But I'm planning to launch this course in August. I hope so. So I hope that we'll be soon ready like that.
Oh, wow. 25 to 30 travels per year. And this is already decreased the number of trips.
Yeah.
I can only imagine exactly how it was before. And I'm also so excited to, I also keep an eye and following your work and your progress on your online course. Why did you decide to focus specifically on teaching aspect of ballet dance for your online course?
First of all, because I hope that I'm a good teacher. I have a very big experience, like I'm teaching about already for 10 years or even more, and I know exactly what to do with different students, I mean with different level. I know what to do, how to bring beginner students to professional, to the champion. I know exactly steps, and I remember my first teaching class when I first came to the group, and I was so nervous. I didn't know what to do. I wasn't prepared, actually. So I want to help these dancers who is going to be a teacher, who want to earn money, to develop their skills also, and to and not to be just a dancer. So I think that that will be very helpful, and I'm going to share everything. There is no secrets. I will show everything, what I do with my students, how I teach, how I explain the movement, because I know that I explain very well. And I will show different ways, like for somebody you need to touch, somebody you need to show, somebody you need to explain with the words. So we will try everything. And also, I remember that for me, it was not easy to create the choreography in the beginning when I had no experience before. So here, some girls will have a few choreographies for their students, for beginners, intermediate, and also professional level. So, you know, like they will not waste their time on searching information, because they will have everything in this online course. So I really hope that that will be useful. I'm sure that that will be useful and that everybody will like it. And now we have like, we're still editing, because there are a lot of videos, a lot of information, especially my favorite part is technique part, where I explain movements. So I'm very, very excited about this. And really, I know that I promised that this course will be ready like almost 1 year ago, but I didn't expect that there is so many information. So that's why it's quite long, but that will be really good quality. That's why, I don't know if I answer your question, Iana.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And all good projects and all good courses, they always take a way longer time than expected, because you just want to put everything in there. So that's quite quite understandable. But also you have sort of you did a pre-launch small DVD related to it. So if people missed that DVD, but they're still interested in this topic, they can try out a shorter version of like little preview of the course, right?
Yeah, that was the idea, yes, because I understand that this online course that will be more expensive than just instructional video, and not everybody ready to pay full amount of money if they don't know what will be inside. So for those who are not sure, they can buy this instructional video, like fundamentals for teachers, and to be and to know the idea how that will be. And but anyway, I decided not to put very high price, because I really want to help. And for me, it's better more people can afford it than, you know, like a few of them. And also, interesting story about these videos. Like 6 months ago, nine videos for this instructional course, I mean for teaching course, was already ready, but I wasn't sure that they're nice, and sent to one of my friends in Germany, and ask her, please tell me the truth, if you like it or not. What do you think about these videos? And she wrote me that, Marta, you are crazy. You already have 9 videos and still waiting. Nice and good. And she really loved it. So I hope that will be really, really useful and people will like it.
I'm absolutely sure it at least sounds absolutely amazing, and knowing your professionalism and knowing your care about your projects, I can only imagine how much love and energy and enthusiasm and knowledge you put into those videos. So I'm so very excited to see them out soon.
I hope so.
Talking about teaching theme, what do you think when someone is actually ready to teach? Because this is a pain point for many dancers, that they don't know, they're not sure if they're ready to start teaching or not. So what do you think, when is this point that the dancer is ready to start teaching?
It's hard to say, because you can learn belly dance 5 years, but twice a week or 2 years every day. So I don't know. It depends. It really depends. But what can I say? That for sure you should be a professional level dancer, at least, not an amateur, a professional with right technique. So first of all, you should be a good dancer with a good technique. And then you need to, maybe before you start teaching people, maybe to try to teach your mother, your sister, I don't know. So to be sure that you can really explain well, because it's a big responsibility to teach. And nowadays I can see that it seems like there are more teachers than students. And everybody who study Oriental dance 1.5, 2 years, they think that it's good for them to start teaching. That's very strange, actually, for me. And it's a sad situation, because I know that a lot of these dancers, they even don't want to improve their teaching skills. They don't visit workshops. They don't study a lot, you know, like just earn money. So I don't think that it's good. I mean, I'm sure that it's a bad situation now. So you need to be sure that you are a professional, first of all. And then try to teach somebody close to you and to see if people understand you first. Then you can try, of course. I mean, I also, when I start teaching, I wasn't professional, actually. I was good amateur. I don't know if it's right to say. I mean, I had good technique, but I had no experience at all in explaining. And the first classes was not good, actually. I didn't like how I teach, and I'm not sure that my students love it, but I was very passionate about that, and I was working hard, and every time I prepare my class, even now with my students, even now, every class, I spend like, I mean, every day, I spend like 1 hour just for preparation for my lessons in my school, because I can't allow myself to go unprepared, you know, just to do something. So it's very important, and it's a big responsibility, I think.
Why do you think this situation happens in ballet dance, that people after like 1-2 years already rush into teach? Like, we don't see this in ballet, for instance, obviously, but like, or some other dance forms, but like in ballet dance, it's very typical. And also you said the point that you need to make sure you're professional, but this is another tricky one. How to know? Because we are... Let's be honest, we are often not objective with ourselves, and we think we are professionals, then we are not yet professionals.
Yeah, I think the main problem is because nobody control us. I mean, we don't have a university where we learn belly dance, because to teach ballet classes, you need to have a diploma of the choreographer or certificate or something like that. In belly dance, I don't know why it's happened. Everybody can start teaching without any certificate. So it's a big issue. I don't know how to solve this problem. Maybe we need to ask somebody like Mogedawi or somebody who will write like some kind of a book, yes, about styles, about movements, like that, because that will be continue. And every time, every new student who, like you say, they will sure that they're very good dancers, and they see the situation that everybody can do it, they will do the same, of course.
Yeah, that's true. Like the lack of system and some kind of standards, it's definitely not serving us good. And the reason also why I asked your opinion is that I remember myself, I was exactly that girl who after I think
me too.
Yeah. I think after 1 year and a half, I was sure I need to start open my school because everyone around was telling me to do so. And I remember I was lucky, literally lucky, that I decided to go to someone else's workshop, someone who I didn't study before, and it was eye-opening for me. I was like, oh my God, there is so much more. Like, what? What teaching are you talking about? So I didn't open, but I remember that feeling, like absolutely being sure, oh yes, I am ready, I'm professional. So,
yeah, I understand you. That was the same with me. My teacher, my first teacher, after 3 years in her school, she asked me to replace her in her group. And I was like, sure, that of course, I'm already a 3 year dancer and I'm so good. But it was not like that, actually. I understand you. Maybe that will be also a good idea if, for example, fitness clubs here with belly dance groups, yes. I mean, directors, managers of the fitness clubs, they will not accept a belly dance teacher without any kind of certificate, without something, not just person from the street who tell you that, okay, I'm a good teacher. So anyway, there should be any kind of control. But I don't know how to do this, actually. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a bit tricky situation. And also the gym is... also very specific, like, style of teaching any physical activity, yeah, including dance. But, like, even certification, it's so easy these days to get whatever kind of certificate, diploma. Like, you just go pay for workshop and people just give you something. So, yeah, but this is a good problem to at least talk about it and highlight it and bring dancers' attention and hopefully their awareness about themselves. And around, like, there is no judging here because we all have been in that situation. Sure. But at least to be aware and be a little bit more critical to yourself on this point, like, would you like to have that teacher for yourself as you are right now? By the way, you mentioned that your first class was sort of initiated by your own teacher. So yes. I assume your teacher was supportive about your teaching activities. But many times dancers face situation that their own teacher is not a big fan of students start teaching.
Yes, and we can understand them, of course. I think that I was very lucky with my teacher because she helped me in the beginning. I don't know. Sometimes I can tell you that in my amateur professional group in my school, sometimes I ask my students to do, for example, warm up or to explain some movements. Sometimes I train them how to teach, and I will be sure that in a few years they will be at least not bad teachers. So I don't say that they will be good even with my training, because everybody is so different. So you can dance well, but not able to explain well. and I correct them. So somebody speak very quiet, yes, so nobody can hear. Somebody can't normally talk and explain also what to do and too nervous. So they need practice, not just 2 years in a school and go teach without experience. So I don't know. I think that's a good idea if teachers will help their students, at least like that, you know, like sometimes in their class, in front of their friends, that will be less nervousness.
That's absolutely awesome idea, how to, for teachers to help their students develop teaching skills. But there can also be completely different situations that teachers don't want their students to teach because of their own personal insecurities.
You're right. I think that it's not good because if you are a professional, if you are a good teacher, so that's absolutely normal if your students will also be good dancers, be good teachers, maybe even better than you. As for me, I always proud of my students. I have a lot of students now who are already teachers and they're good teachers. Somebody better, somebody not, of course, is different, and wonderful dancers, and I really proud of them. I don't feel bad, maybe because I don't stop learning, because if I will stop, of course, all of them will go, you know, like, will be better than me soon. But if you are still learning, if you're always a student, so you always will be the first anyway, and also will have a good name, not just like a dancer, but also as a teacher. I mean, it's our job. It's so perfect. It's so good if you can prepare, if you can teach your students to be a good teacher. That's also wonderful, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And I hope a lot of teachers will also hear those this interview and these words. But can you think about some suggestions for students who are maybe right now in the situations that they feel resistance from their teacher to start their own teaching career, and it's not clear why? Maybe teacher thinks they're not ready, but maybe teacher just doesn't want because of her own like personal insecurities. So how, for students, can you give them some tips how to figure out this situation and just see maybe they need to improve and work on something, or maybe they just need to go ahead despite of teachers? Like, how to navigate the situation in the best and most respectful way and still be true to yourself if you want to teach in the future?
I think the best way is to talk with your teacher, of course, to ask for support. And if your teacher will say no to you, so you are free to go. Maybe it sounds sad, but if somebody doesn't support you, you will feel pressure and bad emotions in the class. So better to leave and find somebody who will help you. First of all, prepare your class. First, second, maybe 1-2 weeks. Yes, so you will know what to do in the class. Or even better, if you have this plan and you have somebody who you can trust, who will help you and check you. So, of course, if you want to do and you're sure that you will be a great teacher, or even if you're not sure but you want to try anyway, so of course do it. Of course do it. But first you need to talk with your teacher, of course.
By the way, you also gave a great tip on first preparing your first few classes and even asking someone who has experience in teaching to check your plan to see if it's ready or not. Can you give a couple of hints on how to get ready for your first class? I'm absolutely sure you probably cover it in your online course, and there will be a bunch of a lot of information about it. But can you give a little highlights, like just to give a taste for our listeners of what's in the course, and give a couple of suggestions for people who are super nervous of their first class, but they still want to try?
Yes, sure, of course. In my opinion, the first class is so important because at this 1 hour, ladies, they decide will they come back to you or not. So they for sure, that should be fun. That should be interesting. You need to choose very nice and fun music, not Kalsum, some kind of drum solo, maybe even not Arabic music. I really love to use Turkish music like Tarkan or Arabic music, but something pop songs like Arash, Bora Bora, or something like that, or even Shakira. That will be much better if you will use this music. Then I think I teach in the first class about 6-7 movements. It depends. So even if the technique is bad, and it will be bad, of course. We don't pay too much attention for this. So, and also the main moment of the first class, usually how I do, that in the end, like we have 20-30 minutes to the end of the class, we create a little combination from the movement that we already taught. So, for example, like hip drop, shimmy, and step with the hip accent. So we do 4 hip drop, step with a hip accent, then shimmy, then step with a hip accent back, then again hip drop. So it's very simple, but really working moment. I know it. I try many times happy because they will realize that it's a first belly dance class, but they are able to dance. So not just movement. We need to put them together. 2, 3, 4 movements, very simple. Again, even if with the bad technique, we encourage them, you are great. So we don't correct technique on the first class, or just maybe a little bit in general. Yes, you show how to do, how you shouldn't do. So that will be much better. And after 2, 3, 4 classes, when you see that dancers, they like you, they want to come back, they will come back to you. So then you can start to go a little bit deeper with the technique, with explanation. But just we need to remember that nobody come to Oriental dance classes to be a professional belly dancer. They come just for fun, to forget their work, yes, to think about something else, just to enjoy. So we need to remember this. We, as a teacher, of course, we love Oriental dance. We want to give them as much information as possible, but in the beginning, they don't need it. So fun music, few movements, like 5, 6, it depends, of course, but not less. So we don't stay long time on one movement. We need to do this interesting. Make jokes sometimes, yes, not to be very serious. Smile, for sure. Speak loudly, so everybody will hear you, and prepared. If you will be prepared, you will be confident. And I always do small combination in the end. So they come back home and they already can show to their husband, mother, daughter, whatever. Yeah, they can show that during this 1 hour or 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, they already able to dance these movements together. So I think that will be perfect. And they will come back for you, I promise.
Oh my God, this is so, so cool. Like, you basically gave a whole layout with so many tips for beginning teachers. And yeah, it's so true. Like, the packaging is so important. Not only the feeling, like, we need to package in the way that people want to see it, to grab their attention, and then we can do with them whatever we want. Yes. That's how I call it. And yes, this, I think, applies to teaching, performing, like whichever service we are talking about. Also, during last few years, at least what I noticed during last few years, you're not only working on your new online project for teachers, but you also pay a lot of attention to your business education. That's how I feel.
Yes, I'm studying marketing. I'm very interested And this, I think, it's our future, and it's good for every business, I mean, for every job, because we need to promote ourselves anyway, even if you are popular and everybody knows about you. But when you stop, promote yourself, you know that there are so many great dancers who want to be on your place. So I feel that even if I don't want sometimes, even if I'm tired, but I need to do this. And actually, it's very interesting. So I bought one course. It's Russian, this course in Russian language, but very interesting. And I worked on my instructional videos and this teacher's course, thanks to this marketing study, and continue to work on myself as a project, like Marta Dancer. It's also my project.
As a brand, I would say also.
Yes, yes, yes. The name of this course was I Am a Brand. So, but all this but all this knowledge that I have from this study, you can apply to everybody as a person. Yes, like you are a brand for yourself or to your project or for somebody who you want to promote. Very interesting, very useful. But I can say it's a huge amount of information. And even now, I don't apply everything because it takes so much time, actually, to do everything. I'm not a promoter. It's hard for me, but I try.
But that's a very interesting point. And why I sort of use this term brand is I'm kind of last few years in the same mindset of trying to figure out like all these things. And I realized that we often don't think about artists as a brand. It's like a personal brand. So it's not like Marta Korzun is your name, but it also in the marketing world, it's kind of, it's a brand. So, yes, and you can work on different projects on that. Yeah. That's so interesting.
Yes. Because you can promote, I'm sorry, because you can promote yourself as an expert. So that was the main idea. So if people trust you, and they respect you, they know that you write and you say good and write things. So everything you, so you can sell yourself, yes, as a teacher, the workshops, for example, or you can sell your like clothes, yes, or training clothes, or your instructional videos, because people trust you, because you show them that you are an expert. So you promote yourself, but you can sell a lot of things because thanks to this is very interesting.
One of the pain points for many dancers is that they try to refuse even thinking about business side of their activities, and main excuse is usually like, oh, I just want to do art, I don't want to do selling, I'm bad at selling, I'm bad at promoting, and this has nothing to do with art. or it sort of like defeats or brings the art, I don't know, the respectability of art lower. Do you agree?
In some moment, you know, if I have a choice, I will hire somebody who will do this for me, really. So I want just to dance. Really, I don't want to do all this promotion, all this advertisement. I don't like it. But I do this because nobody can do this for me and nobody will do better than me. But if I have a choice, I will just dance. But I think if you want to be at least famous, but not just famous, of course, popular, and you want to be invited to different festivals. We now talk about dancers. Again, that may be with every job. So you need to do something or hire somebody who will promote you instead of you. So, I mean, It's business. Anyway, it's business. If you want just to be a dancer, sit in your small city and dance and nobody will know you. Okay, no problem.
And talking about coming back to the topic of teaching and classes,
I know it's a big struggle for teachers, especially beginning teachers who are just starting their schools, on how to promote and market their classes. Because in this case, we are also talking about general audience who doesn't know anything about ballet dance. So it's not even that we can go into details or nuances and talk in the language that other dancers can understand. Like, we are talking about general audience that has nothing, that they don't know anything about ballet dance. So in terms of promoting your own classes, how can someone establish themselves and as an expert, so the general audience would love to and be interested to go and attend their ballet dance classes?
I think the best way is to perform on the public events where people can come for free. You know, this is our audience, yes. Not dancers, but they will look at you, they will see your performance. If they will like it, for sure they should like it, yes. So they will come to you, ask how to go to your school, they want to do the same. So as many times as possible, you need to perform if you have already some students in case, yes, somebody. Also, you put your students to the same events to dance, so, and they always announce who their teacher. So I think it's the best way. Also, what we do here in my city, what works good, we put posters on the public wall, special wall for different advertisements. And people can see the phone number, beautiful picture, like we invite you to Bellydance School of Marta Korzun. This is the phone, and they call and come and try. So maybe also some advertisement in radio, but it depends, I think, on the city, because my city is very small, and it's really enough just to put the posters and to perform everywhere we can, me and my students. But in big cities, I think it's more difficult because, many districts and everybody want to go to the class, which is very close to their home. So anyway, performance is the best. It's the best way to become famous in your city, at least, first. Yes, so people should watch your performance.
I'm very intrigued that you first still, even despite this boom of social media, you still put as the first things in-person performance and physical posters around the city. And that's very interesting and so true that we sometimes pay so much attention to social media that we sort of forget those the very basic things that people can literally see, touch, grab that like postcard or business card and take home. But I was very surprised, but then while you were talking, I was like, huh, that's actually very logical.
No, but I think it's the best if you try everything, of course, on social media, on Instagram, Facebook, or we have in Russia another social media. Try everything. But the best when people look at you and they, you know, like have these feelings that they like you, they want to do the same and they want to come, immediately to your class. This is the best than just a video. But we need to try everything because, for example, grown-ups, they will not sit on Instagram, yes, but somebody 10 years, 15 years old, they will be in Instagram, maybe not on the street. Yes, so we want to attract everybody. So we try different ways.
Yeah, so true. Yeah, so true. Good point, too. When you sort of mentioned that you're planning to release your grand teaching online course in August, where can dancer follow you to make sure that you didn't they didn't miss the announcement? Is it on some web page? Is it on social media? Where they can sort of follow the news?
For sure, all information you can find on my Instagram account and on my Facebook account. And you can purchase this online tutor's course on amazing website for dancers, You Dance. You will find many interesting instructional videos there, as well as my tutor's course.
Well, looking forward to it. And, well, Marta, thank you. Thank you so much for this interview and for so many tips. Like, I kind of feel that all beginning teachers, their brains just on fire right now, overall with information and tips from you. And they can't wait already to check the course and get even more.
Thank you so much for invitation. I'm very happy to be useful and to talk with you. It's my pleasure always. So I hope to see you soon, Iana.
Oh, absolutely. I also would like to finish podcast. You know that we have our signature question that actually started with you. So you already answered it in the episode number one. People, if you missed it somehow, go back and listen to episode number one. It's super easy to find it, as you can imagine, the very first one. But I wanted to slightly like change and just to sum up, I kind of feel our today's general topic was teaching, and especially teaching, how to start teaching, how to get ready for teaching activities. So I wanted to finish with a fun question. Imagine that you can meet yourself, but back in time as a beginning teacher, like just starting. Mm-hmm. What kind of advice would you give to yourself?
Let me think. First, to be confident in yourself, my dear Marta. You will be a good teacher. Don't cry every day after your class. And just be very well prepared. This is the key. No secret. If you are prepared, if you have structure, if you have prepared music, and you have a plan on a sheet of paper with you, in front of you, your class will be successful. This is the secret.
Oh my God. I think just this part of interview is already worth everything. Like, people, if you didn't memorize anything before, like just these few sentences, they mean so much. And thank you for being so open and just sharing how it is, because I am absolutely sure it's very important for people to hear, and something that they can relate to and feel that they're not alone in their struggles.
Oh, for sure not. Yes. We all came through this.
Thank you for listening, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this episode. And if so, do you know the best way to support this project? Is to share it with your friends. It takes a few seconds, costs you nothing, but it helps a lot to move this project forward and help me to bring more awesome guests on the podcast in the future. You can tell your friend, you can send a message, email, you can screenshot and put a post on social media, whatever works better for you. But if every one of you will share this episode at least with one more person, it will make a huge difference for this podcast. Thank you for spending your time with us, for your support and love. And until next time, keep shimming, keep dancing, and I will see you soon.